Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the Alliance Church on this beautiful day outside. Would you stand with us, please, singing glory to His name?
Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. I am so wondrously saved from sin. Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where He took me in. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Come to the fountain so rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let His praises ring.
Glory in the highest, and I'll shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior, standing, standing, unstanding. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises that cannot fail, where the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior, standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
Standing on the promises, I shall not fail. Lifting every moment to the Savior's call. Resting on my Savior as my all in all.
I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
I love You, Lord, and I lift my voice. Worship You, oh my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what You hear. Let the sweet, sweet sound in Your ear. My voice to worship You, oh my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what You hear. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound. Let it
Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the blessings that you've given us. Thank you for each one that is here today and for bringing them here safely. Be with the ones that are hurting. Be with the ones that are sick. Wrap your arms around the people who need comforting. And may we always be in your will. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Wave to each other. Whoa, there we go. Wow. Everything's up here. All right. So, real quick, a ring was found last week and put out. So, I don't know if anyone's missing a ring, but it is here. And so, if you're missing a ring, if not, it goes into a prize box for the kids. So yeah. There you go. We are the family of God, and we like to celebrate milestones in each other's lives. So if you had a birthday from last Saturday or last Monday to today, we'd like to celebrate and sing to you. You can stand. You can stand on the chair. Don't say he is standing on the chair.
David, how old are you now? How old are you, David? Six?
Six.
Whoa!
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
All right. And may God bless you this year. And may, I hope, all those candy, I hope that adds to everything.
Yeah. You just need more candy.
So God bless you, David. And okay. All right. He's interested in that. It's fine. Also, we like to celebrate anniversaries. So if you had an anniversary from last Monday to today, we'd like to celebrate that as well. Nope. All right. As Jim's going to come on up, I want to do a couple of announcements first. You can mosey on up. Okay. So we're going to be doing... what are we doing? We're going to be doing our apologetics class starting this Wednesday at 6 p.m. We're going to be doing a course called Counter Arguments, where we look at an argument from... we have three different ones that we look at from an atheist, a Muslim, and a Mormon. And we're going to look at those three over the course of the class, and then we're going to analyze them and talk about them biblically, how to respond. And then after we're done with that course, probably sometime in January, we're going to be talking about there's a thing called critical race theory that's going around right now. And if you're watching the Black Lives Matter stuff, and you're wondering, what is a Christian response to all this stuff that's going on in our culture? We're going to be talking about that. So we're going to be doing a biblical look at how to respond as Christians. And that will be on, not for a couple months, but that's what we're going to be doing this winter in our apologetics class. So there's that, and I think that's it. If not, I'll just keep talking.
Yeah, you just keep going.
I'm going to... Oh, new people. I'm sorry.
Oh, yeah. You don't get away that easy.
So we like to know where everyone's from. That's why we have the map out there. If this is your first time back or your first time here, we just like to know where you spent the summer and your first name. So we just like you to stand on up, tell your first name and where you spent the summer, and it's just a way for us to kind of get to know more of where we're from. So.
Yeah. Hey.
All right.
Montana.
We got out just before the big snowstorm.
All right. Good. All right. And then right here.
Christine Keister, and I'm from Galena, Illinois.
Oh, good.
Christine.
Good deal.
Ed and Patty, we spent the summer in Alaska.
All right.
Yikes.
And we'll start in the back. All right.
Oh, good.
Okay. Hi, Lorraine Sherrod. I spent the summer in Hayden, Idaho.
And Lorraine was not going to come back, and then she just missed us too much. So, yeah.
Yeah. Good.
There you go.
This is. Oh, man.
That's all right.
We'll get our torches and our pitchforks and come to your house tonight.
Yeah.
Okay.
Don't forget to mention
the what?
Also these.
Oh, yeah. I had it all organized. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning,
Ian. Am I happy to be here?
Yes.
I really am. I'm happy that you're here too. All the new people back. Praise the Lord. Good for you. You messed me all up. I don't know what I'm doing now. I'll go by this right here. November 3rd, Fast for the Nation at noon. And also make sure you go vote. How many of you have already voted? Woohoo! Good for you. Okay, you have a flyer in your thing there. He's not up there right now. Wade Hammond. How many of you have heard him? He was here last year. He is good. He's got a good testimony too. I love that. He's going to be here 6 p.m. next Sunday night, the 8th. Okay. And then Nancy pointed out something. At the 13th, there's going to be a teen fundraiser barbecue from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. Is there a charge? Donation. So hundreds are welcome and 50s? Okay. I don't think a hot dog is going to be worth $100. Never know. You never know. Not hot dogs? Oh, what kind of a barbecue is that?
Pulled pork sandwiches.
Okay.
Chicken.
Oh, wow.
Bottom.
I don't have time to read into the bottom. I've got to do announcements.
You get a baked potato, you get coleslaw, and you get either a soda or a drink of water. I read it earlier.
What if you don't like coleslaw?
Never. I won't be here. Sorry, I'll be on the way to Oregon that night.
Exactly.
Moving on. 16th, there's going to be a church cleanup starting at what time in the morning? What is that, a Monday?
9.
At 9 in the morning. How many of you get up at 9?
Phew.
Yeah, I'll bet you do. And your dad's happy about that. Okay. Do I have to read all these?
Yes.
Okay. 25th of November, Thanksgiving Eve celebration. 26th, Thanksgiving potluck at 1 p.m. We're going to have a bonfire?
Well, it's a 4x4.
Okay. You know, we got in trouble for our last bonfire.
Yeah.
Oh, that was fun. When I leave a place, I like for people to remember me. So that's one way to do it. Also, this here, you got one of these in your program, your announcements. On the back is everything that's going to happen this year. Not this year, and part of next year, too. You're going to get one of these every Sunday. Put the first one on your refrigerator, keep it there, and the next one, it's for you to give away and give it to somebody else. Okay. I thought there was something else. Yeah, there is. Not yet. I'm starting to enjoy this. Tuesday, Tops meets at 7 a.m. in the fellowship hall over there. And again, voting. Who's talking? Wonder. Wednesday, apologetics class. Pastor mentioned that. Thursday, quilting. Again, the quilters. Yes, good for you. At 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. in the fellowship hall. It's getting cool over there, so you can be over there now. Thursdays, we have Bible study at our house in Rainbow Acres at 10 o'clock. Okay, Wednesday, Saturday, fellowship breakfast at the eatery. Okay, that's it. Nancy, huh?
What would tonight be?
Tonight? Sunday evening. Is there anything tonight? What is it?
Sermon discussion.
Okay, this is a quiz.
Yeah. You're failing. You're on the right side there, Jim.
Eight.
Four. Down when you read apologize class. This is tonight.
Worship.
Sermon discussion.
Sermon. All right, Sunday worship at 11 a.m. That's what it says. Come tonight at 6 o'clock in the fellowship or in here? In fellowship hall? Fellowship hall? Who hadn't been to one of these? You're really missing out. There are some cool discussions. We get into some pretty deep stuff, so... What we do is whatever pastor preaches on today, we kind of go over it over there. And like I say, we have some good times. Nuh-uh. Nancy has something about the food handlers.
This next Saturday at 4 o'clock, we're going to have a food handlers class here at the church for you people that help with the food. And the kids that are going to be doing the potluck, there's no charge for that. It takes about 45 minutes or less at 4 o'clock next Saturday. So we'll be over here in the fellowship hall.
Okay. Any questions? Yes.
I would like to congratulate the church. Last night we did the trunk and treat. And we had Faye and myself and my mom was there. And we probably gave out over 100 candy bars to kids. And for the little ones, we gave them marshmallow treats, which they got today. And at the end, they had a drawing for the best decorated one. And we won!
Woo! Yay!
And I got some nice little treats. And Faye said I had to take it.
Yeah. Non-alcoholic, though.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
It's
yeah.
Sparkling cider.
Okay.
Because if it was, I was going to give it to you to auction off.
I think Jim would have.
Okay. Well, let's pray. Just go before the Lord. Remember when we close our eyes, we bow our heads, we're still in this room. But when you pray, you are standing before the throne of God. Father in heaven, we do thank you for your mercies. Father, we thank you for your love. And Father, we just pray that you would continue your blessings of peace and happiness, joy upon each and every one of us. Father, we thank you for your love and especially your mercies and your healing. We just pray that you would continue to bless this church body. Now as we get into the rest of the service, we ask you to open Jeremiah's heart and teach us new and wonderful things. And at the same time, I would pray, Lord, that you would open our hearts and that we would receive your message with thanksgiving and with joy. In Jesus' name we would pray it. Amen. Well, I made it again.
Very good job. All right, so growing up, I have been told by my parents that I wasn't the best of children. They just say that to make themselves feel better. That's what I always figure, because they don't want to. They know I can take it where my sisters can't. So they just say we're all together. Yes, Jeremiah, you were the worst. But I know that they're just saying that because they want my sisters to feel better about themselves. But when I was about first grade, I had a really good friend. His name was Daniel. And where I grew up, the main little town is about the same size as Quartzsite as far as how many people. But it was about 3,500 people, and that's where the school and the local junior high was. And I lived about 20 minutes away in this little town called Comanche, which is around Comanche Lake. If you know anywhere in the Amador County area, this is what we're talking about. And so we would be bused to school every day, right? And it's about a 20-minute drive one way. And I had this really good friend. His name's Daniel. And he lived in town where the school was. And I thought, man, I would love to go and spend, you know, the night over at Daniel's house. But my parents didn't know Daniel's parents, plus they were always real late. You know, both parents worked When I was younger, usually two jobs, and so they would always be there late, so I would be bused by myself. I would get home and spend about an hour alone, even as a little kid, until my sister, who was a few years older than me, would come home and take care of me. Well, I got the bright idea of one day, I'm just going to go over my friend's house. I'll just not go on the bus. And I'll just go and to spend the night at my friend's house. So I did it. One Friday, I said, forget it. I'm just going to walk home with my friend. So I did. And I got to tell you, it was a great afternoon. He lived by the creek in town, and it was in the spring, so the water was running. We couldn't swim, but there was honeysuckle on the banks that was in bloom, and we were able to take those, and that was fun. We hung out at his house, and his mom would say, ask me, your parents know you're here, right? Yeah. And then, but it came to a point where I think she finally figured out what was going on when I said, can I spend the night? And she goes, well, it's fine with me, but I need to talk to your parents. Apparently, my parents were in a fit because...
You didn't come home.
Yes. My sister came home, and there was no me there. And she had contacted all my friends that lived in that area, and I wasn't with any of them. And so my parents had to leave their jobs and come home, and they were frantically searching for me until my friend's mom called. And just suffice it to say, I didn't get to spend the night at Daniel's house. I barely could sit for a while, and I couldn't do anything. But every time Daniel's mom would ask me, are you sure you're supposed to be here? I wouldn't give her a direct answer of no or yes. It was more of, yeah. You know, because I knew what I was doing was wrong. And so every time I would be asked the truth, I would just kind of sweep it to the side and just say, yeah, I am. And so, but that's what we're going to talk about today is this idea of kind of sweeping things to the side. Even when we're not doing something we know isn't right, we kind of just skirt the issue, right? And so that's what we're going to be talking today. So we don't have a place in the Bible that we're going to be, but we've been talking in this series about counterfeit beliefs, about this idea that there are beliefs in this world that are starting to seep their way into the Christian church. And so we've been talking the last 4 weeks, and now we're into our fifth week, about some of these things. And so the first thing we talked about in that week one is this idea of we need to go to God to root out any false beliefs that we personally have that we have incorporated into our lives over time. You know, it can be simple things like God helps those that help themselves, that those sayings that we have in our lives that aren't found in the Bible. And so we need to start really analyzing what do we believe that, and if it goes head to head with the Bible, are we willing to let those things go so that we can be biblical in our beliefs? And so we talked about that first. And we talked about the best way to do that, to know if a false belief is there, is to know the Bible. Right? That's the easiest and quickest way to do this, is to know our Bible so well that when we come across a false idea, we can instantly go, that's wrong. That's what we did the first week. In the second week, we talked about this idea of knowing clues to when a false teacher is a false teacher, right? So we talked about how there are pastors and there are teachers that are out there and they're teaching. And how do we know if a teacher or pastor is a false teacher? And so we talked about four biblical clues that we saw, and they just real quick, they predict things that don't come true, they call people away from God, sometimes they predict something and it will come true, but while they're doing that, they're calling people away from God, so that's a third clue. And the last one is they deny the work, the physical work of Jesus in the flesh. Okay, so he's a historical person, he lived, he died, he resurrected, he's coming again, all right? So it's a denial of what Jesus has done. And so those are four clues that we can kind of look at. If a false teacher will hold to one of those at least, and if they do one, then we have to reject their whole ministry, because what's happening is they might sprinkle in biblical truths every now and then, but what it is, it's calling us away from God, and we're believing things that are not actually from God's word. And so we need to just reject it full on. And sometimes that's really hard, because we might like what someone does, we might like what someone says, but we need to say, I can't be a part of something that's calling me away from God. Okay, so we talked about in the second week. In the third week, we talked about Scripture and how you can tell a false teacher because they diminish the role of Scripture in our lives. That they'll twist it, they'll change it, they'll apply it to us when it's not applicable to us. And a perfect example of this is actually a verse from Romans where it talks about, Paul says, God calls things that were not into existence, okay? And this has been changed to say, you can call things that were not into existence. And you see the difference there? It's something that God does changed to now we're doing that. And that's a false teaching. That's a twisting of Scripture, okay? And so we talked about a diminishing, and one of the quick ways that we can see it in writing is if someone writes something and they lowercase Scripture, or they lowercase especially the Bible. And when you start seeing that, you can already tell that they have a diminished view of Scripture, because they're not even using English correctly in capitalizing Bible, which is a proper noun. Okay, so we talked about that a couple weeks ago. And then last week, we talked about who God is and how false teachers will diminish who He is. And in fact, we saw, and we're using progressive Christianity as kind of our basis from what we're talking about, but this isn't just progressive Christianity. There's a lot of other teachers that do this that are not part of that group, but we're using that as a basis for what we're talking about, because we see in that God is diminished and humanity is elevated to Godhood. And so we were talking about that, how especially in this progressive Christianity, we see that they're taking the uniqueness of God, taking that away, they're taking the intimacy of God away, and they're taking the holiness of God away. Instead, we see a pantheistic, everything's just God, and we are, in a sense, a part of that Godhood. Okay? And so we talked about that last week. And so as we're going through this, we're talking about these ideas that are out there that are being brought into the Christian church, and we need to be on our guard. We need to be able to recognize them and reject them, okay? And so we're going to keep going with that today. But as we're going through, we're going to be talking about this next thing, which is something that the whole world has to ask this question of, why is the world the way it is, right? Why is the world the way it is? Because if you've ever had this with a kid, why is there evil in the world? Why is there problems, right? Why is there malice? Why is there hatred? Why is there wars? Why are there famines? Why are all these bad things in our world? Everyone asks that question at some point in their lives. In fact, this is a huge philosophical question that is constantly being asked. And in fact, probably right now, if you go on online or you go to a debate between a Christian and a non-Christian, usually an atheist, you will see that this is actually a huge question that both sides view as the biggest question that needs to be answered by humanity. Why is the world messed up? And there's really two ways of looking at it. There is that we are evolving to a point where we're at a bad situation, and then we're going to evolve to a utopian situation. Or that we had a good thing going and we messed it up. And that's why we're in the state we are. And this is the biblical view, is that we had paradise, We rebelled against God, and now we're all in sin. And this is the biblical view, and it has been the biblical view for thousands of years, okay, since the writing of the Bible. Does that make sense? Okay. So the question now becomes, what is the progressive Christian view on this? Because that's what we're using as our basis. So do they teach a view of sin that is consistent with the Bible? So I'm going to give you a couple of quotes here, and then we're going to go and talk about what the Bible says. So this comes from Dawn Hutchings. She writes this column, and she writes this: intellectually, I may have understood that it's long past time for Christians in the 21st century to abandon the idea that Christ died on the cross because God needed someone to balance the scale. I may have moved beyond understanding Jesus' death on the cross as a sacrifice for sin, but I am only beginning to move beyond the understanding that nature of humanity is something other than sinful. Okay, so if you're, I hope you're hearing this stuff. Dylan Brown, in his work called What Does Progressive Christianity Believe, he writes this about God, and he believes that God is nudging creation, and he writes this, from a less to more adequate forms and processes. He says, the call to repent and move away from self-centeredness beyond racism, sexism, and homophobia toward economic and ecological justice is an experience of God. Okay, so it's a moving away from sin is the idea. Finally, in her book, Original Blessing, Putting Sin in Its Rightful Place, Danielle Schroer, she writes this, or she says this, Scripture certainly talks about the universal reach of sin, but no passage or verse in the Scripture speaks definitively to the concept of an inborn sin nature. We can take sin seriously without going there. After all, Jesus didn't believe in the original sin, and the disciples in the early church didn't either. What we see in Scripture is a story of people sometimes behaving terribly and people sometimes behaving righteously. It's often the same people. Some call that a sin nature. I think we simply call it human nature. All right, so here are I just giving you these quotes to help us understand where progressive Christianity stands. They hold to this idea that we're progressing, hence the word, we're progressing away from bad things into good things. All right? And in fact, we talked last week a little bit about how the idea of a pantheistic God is based in Eastern religions, such as Hinduism. This idea of progressive sinlessness, of moving away from sin into perfection or betterment, is kind of like Buddhism, which the idea that Buddhism has is this idea of breaking loose of those things that cause suffering. And so eventually you break it through and you reach a higher state. And so it's very similar, the progressive Christianity and Eastern religion along the same lines. And so, but what does the Bible say, right? So she says, Schroer says that she makes a couple claims here, that no sin, that no passage or verse in Scripture speaks of a concept of inborn sin nature, and Jesus and the disciples didn't believe it either. And so now let's talk about what does the Bible actually state, right? But before we get into that, I think one of the things we have to understand is, have you heard the term original sin? Okay. If you haven't heard the term original sin, it sometimes gets misunderstood, and I think that's what Schroer is doing here. She's misunderstanding what original sin is, because usually when I've had conversations with people, the term original sin sounds like this idea of a sin that's original, right? And it's usually believed, or people will tell me, well, that just means that babies have sinned, okay? In fact, if you've ever gone to a place that baptizes infants, this is at the foundation of that, is the idea of you need to baptize a child to get rid or cleanse of original sin. But that's a misunderstanding of what original sin actually is. I'm going to give you another quote, and this actually comes from a little book If I suggest this to anyone, you want to know theological terms, this is probably the best simple book there is. It's called, I call it PDOT, but it's the Pocket Dictionary of Theological Terms. It's a fantastic book, and it's real simple, and you can learn a lot from it. But this is what it says. This is actually what original sin is theologically. Strictly speaking, original sin is the state of alienation from God into which all humans are born. Historically, original sin was connected to the discussion about the manner in which Adam's sin affects all humans, such as through the transmissions of Adam's fallen nature or through God's imputation or crediting of Adam's sin. In other words, original sin isn't that babies have sinned. Rather, the state in which all humans are born into. We're born into a world where sin reigns. That's what original sin, the concept theologically, is in theology. And so the question is does the Bible teach that? Because I'll tell you right now, nowhere in the Bible does it use the terminology original sin. And so just like the Trinity, we have to ask the question, is the concept there? Okay? So let's start going through this. The most direct verse is from Psalm 51, verse 5. Okay, Psalm 51, verse 5, it says this. David's writing, and he says, "Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me." So he's saying sin was there. Okay? In Genesis 8:28, listen to this. Noah is setting up this altar. It's after the flood. He's setting up this altar to worship God. And this happens directly after that. And it says, "And when the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma from this altar, the Lord said in his heart, 'I will never again curse the ground because of man. For the intention of man's heart is evil from his youth.'" Okay? Neither will I again strike down every living creature as I have done. And so God directly says the intention of humanity's heart is to do evil. That's sin. Okay? And then in Ecclesiastes 9:3, Solomon, he writes this. Now I'm going to be reading out of the ESV version because it's a clearer intention than the NIV, which is probably up there. It says, "This is an evil and all that is done under the sun. The same event happens to all, also the hearts of the children of man." Okay? So this just kind of gives an idea that it's just evil, that humanity is evil. But this is, "The hearts of children of man are full of evil, and madness is in their hearts while they live, and after that they go to the dead." And so the intention of that passage is to really pick up, not on just humanity's inclination to do evil, but specifically children's. And if you're a parent, you know this, right? Don't hit your sister, right? Everything's nice and quiet, and you can finally sit down to a cup of tea or a cup of coffee, and you're just like, "Oh, this is so nice." And you're going, "Wait a second. It's quiet." Right?
What's going on?
You know something's wrong, right? We don't have to, this is not something that we don't see in life, right? We understand this. And so if we just stop there, I think that we can see that within the pages of Scripture that there is this understanding that there's original sin. It's here, but we'll keep going because I think we need to. In Romans 7:15, chapter 7, verses 15 through 20, this is one of those popular verses that we've probably heard, and I'm going to read it and prepare to just go back and forth because this is how Paul is writing. He says, "I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is, I no longer I myself who do it, but it is sin living in me. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me. That is my sin nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. Now, if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. Okay? In other words, he's saying, I don't want to do this, but I am compelled to do it. This is my sin nature. It's a desire that we have to do sin. And so the concept of sin, the idea of original sin and sin nature, isn't the idea that a baby is sinful, but rather we are born into a sinful situation and we do it. We are inclined to sin. It's easy to sin. And if we're truthful with ourselves, we agree with that, right? I mean, it's always easier to do what is wrong. And, you know, the old adage that says, it's easier to ask for forgiveness than ask for permission. That is a sinful idea, right? It's, I can ask for forgiveness because I want to do the sin, right? And it's just easier instead of asking for permission, right? And so this idea of being in sin, of being in this world of sin, that's the whole idea. And so it's the environment that we live in. We're in this environment of sin, and we're inclined to sin. And then once we do sin, that's the end. And so when Paul writes in Romans, so this is Romans 3, 10 through 12, he quotes and he says, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. That's just stating the reality of humanity, that we all have sinned. And the question becomes, okay, then how can I, if I'm born into a sinful world, if I am inclined to sin, does that mean that God has caused me to sin? And that's an easy question to come up, and it should be a question that we ask. And so what does the scripture say? So this comes from James in his first letter. He says this, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desires and enticed. Then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, gives birth to death. So it's not that God, that we're in this situation and now we don't have any power. It's our own desire apart from God that drags us into sin. I mean, and that's true, right? If we are honest with ourselves and we look and we say, it's not their fault, really. It is my fault that I have sinned. And when I write these up, when I write up my sermons, every once in a while I throw something in there just to make Marika laugh. And in this one, I want to share with you what I said to her. I said, as a side note, we know that it's not because of children that parents sin, because Adam didn't have children when he sinned. It's not their fault that we sin. We are dragged away by our desire to have peace and quiet. And there's children. Right? It's not their fault. And it's never anyone else's fault. The fault of sin is always, through Scripture, placed on us as individuals. It's never someone else's fault. And that's a huge thing, because if we start blaming other people, then we skirt the issue, right? We start sweeping aside sin, and it's not me, I just want to have fun. And we start lowering what it is. But with Paul and what the scriptures say, that we all have sinned, Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We are all in this together. This isn't them versus us type of stuff. This isn't those bad people out there and us good people over here. You know, one of the easiest, if we go back in time, we go back and we go to World War II, right? And if you start looking, there was a lot of atrocities that happened, right? That we know of, Holocaust, right? And all these things, all these atrocities. If we start looking at the American side of it, and we start looking at the in the newspapers and things like that, how were Japanese and Germans depicted in the newspapers? As evil. The reason why is because it's easy to hate someone by making them evil, right? It makes things easier. When we start realizing the sharedness in this, one of the things, if you ever read the book, Why Does God Allow Evil? It's by Clay Jones, Pastor Jeff's brother. It's a fantastic book. One of the things he goes through in that book is this idea that we always think of people as monsters, right? That do these horrific acts. And the reality, they've done studies about it's just us. The most human people are doing the most horrific things. And that's because of sin. We need to wake up to the understanding that we are sinful. That's a huge thing. But the question becomes, where does it lead? What's next? Okay, there's sin. All right. Well, in the Bible, there's good news, but for progressive Christianity, it's just, well, we just need to change ideas, change attitudes, and just move away from it. So Delwyn Brown, he talks about move away from self-centeredness, beyond racism, beyond sexism and homophobia toward economic and ecological justice. Basically, you just move beyond the bad stuff and then you become good. But what does Scripture say? Everyone's heard John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall have eternal life. Yes, my children know this verse. Okay? What's next after that verse? Listen to this. Verse 17. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already. You hear that? Stands condemned already because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. I want to piggyback that with Ephesians 2. Listen to what Paul says in Ephesians 2. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you were once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. Where does sin go? The Bible says it leads to death. And it's not just a physical death where it's just, okay, well, once I shred this, then everything's okay. No, it's a physical death of this body. It's an eternal death, first in hell and then into the lake of fire. That's where sin leads us. But the Bible also gives hope. There's good news. It says it there, right there in John 3:18. Whoever believes in him, believes in Jesus, is not condemned. There's only one thing that stops the condemnation where sin takes us, and that's belief in Jesus as Savior. It's the only thing. And if we keep reading in Ephesians 2, verse 4 starts with this, but because of his great love for us, God is rich in mercy and made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved, and God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming age he might show incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Now think about that. So what progressive Christianity is saying is you need to work your way from bad and you need to work until you become good enough. And the Bible says that's an impossibility because we're children of wrath. We are condemned right now because of sin. So how do we get goodness? Trust in Jesus as Savior. That's it. We trust in Jesus as Savior. It's as simple as that. Because Paul, like he just says, it's not by works. We can't do it. We can't be good enough. There's no way. Because if we are really truthful and we're walking through this world and we start saying, I'm going to be the best right now, go drive down the street. And I'll tell you what, there will be someone that goes in front of you at 10 miles an hour and a 35, and you're going to be driving, you're going to be like, just get out of the way. Right? And I'll tell you, as soon as you have contempt for that person, guess what? You have failed. It's that simple. We tend to think of sin as the big stuff, but it's the little things that draw us away, step by step, away from God. And so, this idea that we're going to get better is just fallacious. It's false. In fact, read through Matthew 24. Jesus says, I think it's like verse 4, verse 5, he says, as in the days of Noah, so shall it be when the Son of Man returns. Now, if you go back and read Genesis, where it's talking about the time period, God says every inclination of the hearts of men were for evil. I mean, think of what that means. We think it's bad now. God says, as in the days of Noah, that's when the Son of Man is going to return. Every day, if you turn on your TV, you see just more and more and more evil in this world. And we're not there yet. Every inclination of the hearts of man was to do evil. That's how it's going to be when the return of Christ happens. And yet, all that is required of us is to accept Jesus as Savior. And what's that mean? We encounter a realization of, I am sinful. And there's nothing I can do. I need a Savior. And in a couple of weeks, we're going to talk about the work of Christ and what that really means. But at this point, we're just talking about we need to realize our sinfulness. And at that point, the grace of God. And I'm teaching a course for our homeschool group about apologetics. And we're talking about justice and mercy. Justice, a simple way of understanding all of it, is justice is the punishment for the crime, right? Okay? For us, the justice would be for God to go, you're gone. Because sin deserves death. Mercy is saying you're forgiven for what has happened. Grace is bringing you up higher than you were. Amen. And that's what God does. He doesn't say, you're forgiven, go about your business. He says, I'm bringing you up higher. And so when this body is dead, this shell that has been ravaged by sin is gone, we have a new body in glory. Amen. Why? Because we were created to have this body, and it was sin destroyed. And God says, I got something better for you. I'm taking care of justice that was on the cross, and we'll talk about that more in a couple weeks. Mercy was, you're forgiven. Grace is, we get to spend eternity with God. That is what the scriptures teach. So it doesn't say progress and become better. It says realize that you can't. Trust the Savior and spend eternity with God. As simple as that. And so, but we, and this is what that is, we have the tendency to just sweep sin away. Why? Because to make ourselves better, feel better about ourselves. I didn't tell that mom that I wasn't supposed to be there because I was enjoying my time with my friend. And so what we do with sin, we just kind of sweep it to the side so that we don't have to deal with it. But we need to. Until we deal with sin, we're going to keep struggling. But I want to challenge you guys to do something this week. If you haven't accepted Jesus as your Savior, I want to challenge you to struggle with sin. To really struggle with it. Not to sweep it to the side, not to say, oh, but it's just, I just made a little white lie. Really deal with sin. Really say, am I doing what is really right? And you might not believe in God, but I want to challenge you to go and talk to God and say, God, if I am really a sinner, show me. Because you know one of the roles of the Holy Spirit is to convict of sin. And when we challenge God in that department, God fulfills. It's one of those things that God always fulfills. It's like patience. Never ask for patience unless you're ready for God to fulfill that, because He will. And so I want to challenge you to start struggling with sin. Okay? And if you come to a place as you struggle where you realize, I am a sinner, all that it takes is to cry out to Jesus and accept His free gift. That He has taken care of every single punishment for your sin. And one of the reasons why I share the stories I do about my own life, about my own sinful side, about how I've fallen to sin, is because I want us to understand it's not you, it's us. We all fall there. The only difference between a Christian and a non-Christian is one, the non-Christian is under wrath right now from God, and the Christian has been moved from death to life. That's it. We still struggle with sin, but we are forgiven. And in fact, this is the next thing, brothers and sisters, I want to challenge you this week. You might have accepted Jesus and you might have been following Him for years or months or whatever. Are you playing with sin? Years ago, I had this dream where I was at a house. It was kind of like a track house. Okay, and I was sweeping out the garage and there was a snake, a rattlesnake. And I was kind of just messing with it, right? And from that, I really do believe this is a dream from God, that I, at that point in my life, was playing around with sin. And at any point, that sin could jump at me and take me out. And it was a moment where I'm like, I need to stop playing with sin. And so, believer, are you playing with sin? Are you sweeping it off to the side? Your salvation, I'm not saying your salvation is in jeopardy. What I'm saying is you're building roadblocks between you and God. You're not experiencing Him the way He intends you to experience Him, which is phenomenal compared to what you're doing right now. So this week, I want to challenge you, go before God. God, am I playing with sin? And if you are, confess it. You know, 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. That letter is not written to non-believers. That letter is written to believers. All it takes is confession, and this is the way I always view it. As we're building our sin, as we're doing sin, we're building this little wall between us and God. All it says is, all we need is, God, I built this. Take it away. And God comes with a sledgehammer, just tsh. All right, you're back in fellowship. Let's go. And so I want to do that. And we don't do good works, brothers and sisters, because it earns us salvation. That's not what it does. Instead, it's saying, God, Father, I love you enough to do this. I appreciate what you have done in my life. I know where I was, and I see where you've brought me, and I want to do good, not because it earns me anything, but because you are deserving of it. Because he is a holy God. We talked about that last word. He is a holy God, and he has called us to be a holy people. So let's do that. Let's be a holy people, recognizing sin, being honest with God about it, so our fellowship with God would go deeper and his light would shine brighter in us. Sound good? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for all that you do for us. God, you are a good God. And Father, you saved us not because we are good, but because you are. Father, I pray that if anyone in here does not know you, that they would struggle with sin this week and that you would meet them there and show them your goodness. Show them that there is a way through Jesus alone that will bring them to you. That all sin, all guilt will be wiped away because of what Jesus did on the cross. And Father, I thank you that you proved it through the resurrection, that you stamped it, you codified it, you said this is real stuff. The forgiveness that is through the cross is real because of the resurrection of Jesus. So Father, I pray for anyone in here that does not know you, that they would start struggling, that the Holy Spirit would be convicting. And Father, for us that have put our faith into you, we are trusting in Jesus as our Savior, that we would not play with sin, that you would take it away from us all the way. So Father, I thank you. It's in your Son's name I pray, amen.
Communion?
We're going to take communion right now, and it's a perfect time to go before God and really deal with things. And so today, I'm going to have the guys come on up, and we're going to take communion, we're going to take the bread, and we're going to take the cup, and we're going to go before God. And so, I could get you guys to come on over. Perfect timing, you see that? We planned that.
You did.
So let's pray for this time. Heavenly Father, as we're taking communion, as Jesus instructed us to do, Lord, be working in our lives right now, in our hearts. Open it to your leading by the power of the Holy Spirit, that we would recognize anything that is not of you, that we would give it up to you right now, that we would confess, and that we would remember that your Son's body was broken on our behalf. Because of Jesus, you went to the cross when we should have. But you took our pain, you took the suffering, you took the punishment all on yourself so that we wouldn't have to. And so, Lord, we praise you for that. And Lord, as we're taking this bread, move us to a closer relationship with you. I ask this in your Son's name. Amen.
Would you be free from the burden of sin?
There's power in the blood, power in the blood.
Would you or evil a victory win?
There's wonderful power in the blood.
There is power, power, wonder-working power
in the blood.
From your passion and pride,
there's power in the blood, power in the blood.
Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide,
there's wonderful power in the blood.
There is power, power, wonder-working power
in the blood of the Lamb.
There is power, power, wonder-working
in the precious blood of the Lamb.
as we're holding the bread, let's take a look at it. I don't have mine because they took off. But look at that bread. There's not much there, right? Thank you. No, there's not. There's not much. Let's be honest, it doesn't taste very good. Right? It's unleavened. It's unedible, too. But the point, what is the point? Is it to be tasteful? Is it to be something that is here so that we can say, man, that was some tasty bread? No. It's representative of the body of Christ broken. Yeah. It's the covenant that God has with us saying, you know what? All it takes is belief and trust in Jesus, and the body is broken for you, for me. That's what this is. This thing that is a couple cents worth is worth so much because it costs the life of Christ on our behalf. So as we take it, it's not just a piece of bread. We're taking it saying, Lord, this is what you've done for me. You've broken the body of Christ for me. So as we take it, let's think about it. Heavenly Father, thank you for the body that was broken for us to bring us to you. Thank you in your Son's name. Let's take. So just like the bread, there's not much to the cup, right? It's grape juice, a couple cents worth, and a plastic cup that can break real easily. So don't squish it. But it represents everything. There's power in the blood.
Amen.
Sin is washed away through the blood of Christ. Not yet. And so as we're taking it, it is valuable, not because of what it is, but because of what it represents. Death to life. From darkness to light. from eternity separated to eternity with God. That's what it represents. So as we take it, let's focus not on the here and now, because there's a lot of problems in our life, but in that eternity that we access through Christ, because He's good. Heavenly Father, thank You for the spilt blood of Christ on our behalf. It is good for us, abhorrent for Him, but He loves us so much that He came to sacrifice Himself. And Jesus, I thank You for that. I thank You so much that You did what we were deserving of, and You were not. And You did it on behalf of us. Thank You so much for Your spilt blood, that we praise You as we remember by taking this cup. Lord, I thank You. I praise You. In Your Son's name, amen. Let's take. Thank you very much. You can pass to the sides.
One more song and then offering?
Yeah. Let them, give them a moment.
See what time do the offering?
Okay. All right. So Cookie's saying we're going to take an offering. So guys, you got to move. Hang on. Yeah, run. I was trying to give you some time, but she wants you guys to to book it.
Did they eat their meeting this morning?
Yeah. But, you know, one of the things about our church is it's hopefully we have some fun. And hopefully you leave here uplifted, fed by the Word of God. And you walk out and you go, man, I got more together than those people do. So,
yeah.
This is about helping you in your lives as well. So. And plus, it makes you guys feel better, right?
Yeah, you see, these guys are on the ball.
Yeah. They're good. They're in shape, man. I don't know what kind of shape, but they're there. But as we're taking an offering, this is a part of our worship. The same with singing. Hi, guys.
I'm not sure
how
to do it.
This is really part of our worship. The singing is worship back to God. Reading through the scriptures, doing that, it's a part of worship. And so when we take communion, it's a part of our worship. And as we're doing an offering, it's a part of worship. It's just another aspect of it. And so I've been asked, why don't we just do the little box in the back and just do that? It's like, that's fine, and we have that available. But one of the reasons why we continue to do this tradition is because it is a way for us to give back to God. And one of the things that we don't do is we don't put it up here and make you come up here, right? Because it's not about you being a spectacle, right? It's about this is a time, just like communion can be an intimate time with God, so too is the giving. Because it's saying, I'm giving this up. And it's that physical act. And so that's why we do it. Okay? But we say this again and again, we don't want the Alliance Church built, because this building, this ministry, someday it'll be gone. What we want built is God's kingdom and to be used wherever He wants us to be. It's His church that is built by Him, and we're just here as servants going about the Master's work. And that's what we want. And so let's go to God with that mindset. Heavenly Father, build Your church. Jesus, this is Your body. Build it the way You see fit. Lord, we ask that people, especially now as more people are coming into Quartzsite, that the gospel would get out, that people would know You, that they would follow You, that Your people would cling tighter to You, especially with all this stuff that's going on in our society. Lord, we lift up our nation to You. The elections are going to happen. Ballots are already being cast. They're already being counted. Lord, we give everything to You. We know we're not citizens of this world. We are citizens of Your kingdom. But Lord, You've placed us into this place, and we desire the best for our country. And so, Lord, as we're giving our offering, we're asking, Lord, do work. Lord, you created man out of the dirt. You are a God that gets dirty. And so, Father, there's a lot of dirt here that needs to be molded. Lord, do a good work. We praise you because you have done so much. You've done all that is required for salvation. And you are doing and moving in ways we can't even imagine. Lord, we ask to be servants of it. So as we're giving this offering, help us to be servants. Help us to see where you're working and be in that. Lord, I thank you so much for all that you do in your people's lives and all the things that you're going to do. So I ask this all in your son's name. Amen.
Songwriting is a gift, and the Lord sent me this one. Hey, don't go flying a flag out by your front door. And don't go pray to Jesus, that's not proper anymore. For things have changed and this old world just can't stay behind. Guess it's just a sign of the time.
The violence on TV, the games our kids are playing, the rulings of the court on what we do and what we say, the floods and earthquakes worldwide and death and hurricanes, it's just another sign of the time. It says in the Bible God will send a sign. Are we seeing what we see, or are we all too blind? For when Jesus comes, will we be ready? Just because we know this was a sign of the time. So watch and wait, my brothers, hold close, my sisters. For times change so slowly, it bursts year by year. The things our Bible teaches aren't what's in others' minds. It's just another sign of the time. Remember in the Bible, Sodom and their evil ways. How close are we getting to what they had in their days? Doesn't anybody really care, or have we just become a world with a sign of the time? It says in the Bible God will send a sign. Are we seeing what we see, or are we all too blind? For when Jesus comes, will we be ready? Just because we know this was a sign of the time. When Jesus comes, I hope we'll all be ready, because he sent a sign of the time.
Thank you. God writes good stuff. I'd like to bring my worship team back up. We had for a while people requesting songs, and we had this one requested from Cindy. I mean, she's responsible for these two. So it's called A New Name in Glory.
Ready, Greg?
I was once a sinner, but I came hardened to receive from my Lord.
Would you stand, please?
This was freely given, and I found that he always kept his word. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angel sang the story. A sinner has come home. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam. I was humbly kneeling at the cross, fearing not but God's angry frown. When the heavens opened and I saw that my name was written down, and there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And
the white-robed angel sang the story. A sinner has come home. For there's a new name written down in glory. And it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam.
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah.
Okay, I got four questions for you real quick. Is God on his throne today?
Amen, yes.
Will God be on his throne tomorrow?
Yes.
Will God be on his throne on Tuesday?
Yes.
Will God be on his throne on Wednesday?
Yes.
Don't let the elections direct your life. Okay? God is in control no matter what. And with all whatever happens afterwards, God is in control. Let's live as the people of God with God being in control. Sound good?
Amen.
God bless you. Have a great week. And go vote if you haven't.